Everyone, I hope that you are having a wonderful day. It is a stupid cold and snowy day where I am. We've got ice on the ground so far this morning, and it has just started snowing, and I see like snow blowing outside my window. It's gross. In just a second, as soon as I get all of my ducks in a row, I'm going to have Eden Castile on with me. Meanwhile, I try to boop and talk at the same time. Doesn't happen very well usually. And here she comes. Hey, Eden!
Hello. Hi, can you hear me okay?
Oh, I can't hear you.
Dance. How about now? If I just turn off.
I hear you, but you're still quiet.
Okay, I'm gonna put these away. Any better?
Not really, not yet.
Okay, I have a couple of other things I can try. I have wired ones. So, what do you use?
I am just on air sound right now. I don't have anything on right now.
Okay, just air sound. All right, I'll turn off my other ones and see if it gets any better. So, but this is as loud as I get. I'm not loud enough. If I get really close, does that help?
It's still really quiet for
So I'm really
me,
quiet.
but let me see what happens if I turn you up. Let's see. Try again, please.
Trying again, trying again.
Still pretty quiet, but I can hear you.
Okay. All right. So keep talking. And actually, you know what? I'll just take you on a little tour. I'm going to
Okay.
go over to my tech cabinet and find the adapter that lets me put in my wired headphones. So, right?
See, this is the world that we live in, though, where we have to, we have to flow with whatever technology throws at us because, oh, very cute cat pillows.
Thank you.
So, like, I don't know. I've told people before that I think technology is,
The devil.
like the worst terrorist on the planet some days. Because
Yes.
you
All
just
right.
cannot negotiate.
I'm putting you back in the holder. All right. I have MacGyvered this like you wouldn't believe. So I'm trying to be all professional and crap. Well, we don't know how that's going to go. So I have one pair of wired phones, right? And it's got two different dongles. So I have the USB-C dongle and the lightning dongle. So now I'm going to put in the lightning dongle and hope for the best.
Okay.
Please, God, work. Can you hear me?
That is
Yes.
better. Yes, much, much
Better?
better.
Okay. All right. Okay.
See?
All right. There. One technology problem solved today. That's it. That's all you get.
Yeah. I mean, it's
Right?
still a little quiet, but I can hear you better.
Okay. I don't know. Maybe it's my phone. I'm up to maximum
Oh.
here. So I don't know. And these, I have issues. Okay. I have issues. But I have issues with Apple and
Yeah,
with the
that's a
sound
different kind
stuff.
of interview, Eden, so.
I know. I know. So, I mean, can I complain about my Apple products with you? That's what this whole hour is about, right? Me complaining about my Apple products because I'm ready to do that. Maybe not.
I mean, we
Okay.
absolutely can. I'm on
Okay.
Android, so maybe I'm just feeling superior right now.
That's probably it. That's probably it. I mean, I am a walking Mac ad right now. But like my iPad, the sound is really, really soft, and usually the phone is better, except when it's not. So,
Right.
yeah, you never can tell. So I'm also going to risk punching this little mute button and just see if it has a volume control. It probably doesn't.
Okay.
Nope, it doesn't. Okay.
Okay.
This is it. I'll just talk loud as I can and try to make this
You're a
interesting.
singer, you know how to project.
That's right. La voce. Come out. Come out. All right. Anyway, it is great to see you. And you got snow? Lots of snow?
It's coming. Yeah, we're gonna have way more snow tonight. Like it's 6 or 8 inches or so overnight. It's snowing earlier than they were predicting. We were supposed to have like we had ice this morning, and then like we were supposed to have like a gap, and then it was supposed to start snowing like after dark, and it's snowing now. So like, okay, maybe it's
Yeah.
going to be worse.
We had a blizzard on Saturday and we had about a foot and a
Yeah.
half. And yeah, it's slowly melting. Tomorrow it'll rain and push most of it away. So yay, tis the season. Tis the season.
Yep. We haven't had a snow this big for probably 8 years, I think, is what they said on the news this morning. We tend to get ice in my part of the state more than we get snow. And today we're getting ice and then snow on top of it. It's going to be fantastic.
Oh,
What could
great.
go wrong?
What could go wrong? That's what I say every time I live stream. What could go wrong? Which one is now? Yeah, that's what I
I
do.
know. So I'm really glad that we get to chat today. You've been doing like all kinds of shows on YouTube and Facebook Lives and all of that stuff. Are you out of Facebook jail yet?
Yes, I was in
Oh, good.
for 2 weeks. I think I just had to run out the clock. But yeah, I was live streaming a couple weeks ago, and then 1 minute into my live stream on Facebook, I got banned. And then when I got back on
So
about half
weird.
an hour, yeah, it was really stupid. And it was just like I caught in a spam filter or an AI filter. And I appealed, and he said, I get it, but he said, you're probably just gonna have to run out the clock. We'll be back in touch. Never were, of course. So then finally, 2 weeks later, I just did a live for fun just to see if it would work. And all of a sudden, it went live. And that's how I knew I was out of jail. I never got a notification or anything. And it wasn't really explained why I ended up getting banned, except I was doing the live stream and I was asking using a piece of technology called Restream Chat. I was asking people, tell us where you're watching from. And he said that may have triggered a violation because it went out to so many channels at once that he may have thought
Interesting.
maybe they thought I was spamming. So, whatever, it was not fun. But like any other limitation, like 6 feet of snow or bad audio, it made me have to think about other ways of reaching an audience, right? So no Facebook. And I realize I do get a lot of casual viewers from that, but I did LinkedIn. I worked harder to work on Twitch. I worked really hard on YouTube. YouTube's my number one. Sorry, Instagram. But that worked out okay. So actually I picked up more subscribers on YouTube because they couldn't see me on Facebook. So now I'm back on Facebook and I appreciate it, but I'm also still working those other channels.
Yeah,
So you do.
I hate that you had to go through that, but like at the same time, I think it illustrates too that we can't put all of our eggs in one basket because if we do, like who knows, Zuckerberg's behind, poking buttons and pulling levers and we're just at his mercy. Or his whims, whatever, and so having the versatility to be able to change and adapt, maybe not always on the fly. We don't always have the ability to do that on a dime, but at least having options and knowing ahead of time that you can do different things so you don't like absolutely freak out. I mean, it's the same thing that we've learned with online lessons. What do you do? We all started on Zoom, and what do you do when Zoom just goes to crap? Have an extra plan, have something in your back pocket.
Yeah, we as singers know that. Is that, you don't have just one finishing song. You really have two or three ready to go. And our audition books have five songs in them for a reason, because we don't know what's going to be expected of us. But when it comes to technology, if we don't push the button and it works perfectly the first time, we throw our hands up and say, oh, I can't do it. No, you need to
Yeah,
have
that's true.
five different versions of tech, at least two. I mean, look, you came on, right? I tried these. These didn't work. So then I had my backup. I have one more backup sitting here too. I have three different ways of connecting because I know something's going to fail. That's the lesson, boys and girls. Something's going to fail. So be ready for that, right? And just have a backup. It did not cost me much to have this dongle, but I'm sure I'm glad I had it. And it makes you feel so much more confident when you know that you have an alternative or two alternatives. And when it comes to tech online, you got to have that.
So, we have already kind of launched into that, but before we get too much farther, would you just kind of tell everybody like who you are, what do you do, why are you tell
Sure.
us
I'm
the
looking at my
things,
notes.
Eden.
Hi, I'm Eden Castile, and thank you for watching. I see a couple people watching. And I live in Wakefield, Rhode Island, and I am a voice coach, music producer, singer-songwriter, and coach and performer. That's the big four, I think. But I help people take whatever musical dream they have and actually, launch that to something in reality. For most of my clients now, it tends to be like wanting to perform a one-person show or create some kind of an album of their own art, their own recordings. So most of my clients are doing one of those two things, either in a big way or a bunch of small steps leading up to the big finale.
I got to know you through the Speakeasy Cooperative. We're both members, and I like you did a what we call the virtual cocktail brunch or cocktail party or something, I think last year, maybe the year before, about one of your clients who is doing a one-woman show. I think she's doing another one this year, or she's working on another one. And boy, howdy, I was just, first of all, she was delightful. She was wonderful to watch. But just The amount of personalization that you did for her, that I mean, it wasn't just pulling a bunch of songs together, basically doing like a jukebox recital. Like you had a whole story crafted. You had an arc that you were following with her, and she was really telling a story through her songs. And it wasn't, the
It's
amount
her
of
life.
personalization that you did was really incredible.
Thank you. I was going to see if I could pull it up, but I realized I have to actually show you a picture on the screen. That's going to be like, that shows how old I am. Anyway, yeah, it's Eliza Collins, and she is doing her one-woman show, Sex and the Older Girl, and she's repeating that in Warwick, Rhode Island on March 20th. So today, for her, as my client, I helped, we finalized the booking of the venue. And I sent off the art that I created using PicMonkey. I also sent off the press release so that way they can create the ticket portal. I also created a Facebook event and so that the theater can be a co-host for that. But those are all steps that individual artists know how to do when they've done them, but you learn them a little bit over time, right? So,
Right.
but I get clients who have never even considered that. Eliza's 83. And so it's not going to immediately be clear to her what steps she needs to do, even though she's a published playwright and writer and very esteemed. So I just help keep her organized and I help her think of all of those steps and make sure that they get executed in a timely manner. So that way she can do what she's great at, which is telling and singing her story. So yeah. So yeah, she's doing that. We're really excited. She's going to be in here tomorrow to start rehearsing. She wrote a new opening number. So we're working on that now.
That's exciting. I think, just my opinion, I think you're uniquely qualified to do stuff like this just because of how the performing that you've done. What I know of you a little bit, like you have done cabaret shows yourself, correct me if I'm wrong. And you have been doing the weekly Eden show for quite a while now, and those are kind of like online streamed cabaret shows that unfortunately got you in Facebook Live jail for a couple weeks, but
Yeah.
whatever.
Yes,
Yeah,
I'm on
but
episode 42 of the Eden Show.
yeah.
So, do you want me to tell you how it started?
Yes, please.
Okay, so it started actually as a live event in Providence, Rhode Island, in 2019. I had been hosting kind of little open mics here and there, or whatever, just playing piano for people because I like doing that, and because my students needed performing experience. So I thought, well, I'll just host open mic, which is my version of a recital. Right, they still need to prepare the music, and they still need to get up and perform. So, but it felt like lower stress for them. And if you do it more frequently than like twice a year, then they just get more experience. It's all about that. They just need the experience, the chance, right? So I thought, well, why don't I do it in kind of this fun variety show format, and then I can mix some of my singers in with some of my friends who are performers, and it'll be like the Carol Burnett Show or something, only much more musical. And we won't do skits, but we'll be singing and people will just drop by. And I got two of them in, and I did them at a restaurant in Providence that is now closed. But it was such a pain in the patootie to book the place, schedule the place, haul everything up, get people to commit to perform, and get people to show up, pay for dinner, and a show. So I got two out of it before the pandemic, and then nothing, right? And I thought, oh, that was a great idea. It wouldn't happen. And then over the course of that first year of the pandemic, I began developing my live streaming skills. So, like everybody else, I was on Zoom. But then one of my student projects was to do an album. It was going to be a live show, but because nobody could get together, we turned it into an album. And then I wanted to promote the album. So I thought, I really want to live stream with each of these students and talk with them about their success. So in December of 2020, I did that. I got on StreamYard.com and I live streamed. I brought in each student over the course of 1 week and we talked about it, their song that they wrote, and we played the video that we created together of their songs. 1 solid week. It was like my, Christmas, really. And I got viewers. It was really fun. And I realized, oh, I already have all the skills in place. And so then the next month, January of 2021, I restarted the Eden Show. So, and now we're on episode 42.
Very cool. Now, I was talking with I forget who now, but we were talking about how video skills in particular are going to be essential for
singers basically from here on out. Because if you are, regardless of what you're auditioning for, college programs are moving to a lot of video submission. Some of them were already doing that even before the pandemic, but even now, like last year, I judged high school choirs and ensembles, and it was all video based. And so to be able to put yourself on video in a way that really like highlights your skills, so we're not distracted by the technology. The technology is just a tool, it's not an obstacle, is so very important. And I can imagine, especially now, that live streaming too is going to be a skill for a lot of singers to be able to master. And I'm wondering, this is not a question that I sent to you, sorry, but can you like give us your take on what the differences are between live streaming and like creating a video submission, and like how singers can prepare for live streaming if they're used to doing video, that kind of thing?
Sure, absolutely. Yes, probably most people or most singers in the past couple of years have done the self-tape, have done a video audition. So you've been able to practice those skills. And then you go back and you look at it and you realize, oh, that light was wrong, or I have a shadow on my face. Redo, right? That's the great thing. You can do it again and again. We're in a live situation, right? You're stuck with just walking on stage and singing it once and you're done. So that's the benefit of the video audition. Oh gosh, no. It's my phone, right? I didn't turn off my messages. So the difference for live streaming is basically it puts that live element back in for better or for worse. And you still have to have really good tech, right? So I love that kind of a challenge, but it can make other people just want to go into a hole and hide. I get it. So you need to have basically all those same elements in place. You need to have decent audio. You need to have decent lighting. I've got one, two, three, four, five, six, seven lights in this room right now. So those two things are really important. And of the two, the audio is more important, right? For singers, and generally, audio is more important. Then you also have to have a clear idea of what you're going to do. So you're slating and you're on camera and you're live. So it combines some of those two things. And so if you're comfortable with both of those separately, you're probably going to do okay together. If you're not comfortable with one of those elements, we are going to notice it like crazy when you start to live stream. So the key is to practice, right? Instagram has a way of going live privately. I just figured that out. So yeah, do that. I don't actually live stream my show on Instagram because I would have to jailbreak everything. And I just got out of jail, so I'm not going to go in again. But when I'm live streaming my show, I practice it all the time, and with my guest of the week as well. I practice, I practice, I practice. I tend to put my practices on Twitch because a lot of people are not watching me on Twitch. And Twitch rewards us for being online for forever, whereas the other platforms don't as much. So Twitch loves it, and it counts towards my monthly total. So I'll throw up, me warming up in the morning on Twitch on my channel. Or if I'm practicing tech with a guest, we'll go onto Twitch so that way they can see it works. And but before we do the actual show. So if you're a performer, I do think that live stream is going to be part of your musical future. If you want it to be, I think when in this interim period for the next several years, you're going to be able to choose to opt in or opt out. But in the next generation, it will be part of what we do. And the live streaming tech will get easier and easier and more sophisticated. Right now, we're not completely plug and play. Right now, you still have to have some tech skill in order to be able to set up and to operate and to troubleshoot a lot of problems, similar to how you used to have to code your own website. So, but it's coming where it's going to get a lot easier and built in. So right now, I use a variety of companies to do all of this stuff, and I just pick and choose what works for me. But eventually, I do think that each one of these platforms will have a really good streaming option with all the things set up.
So for voice teachers in particular, because that's generally who I talk to is other voice teachers, what do you think they need to learn or like put on their list to start learning in the next couple of years so that they can guide their clients toward that?
Number one, be connected to Ethernet. To your router. Okay. Do I have the Ethernet cable over here? No, of course I do not. I put it away. I put it away in my junk drawer. But basically, Ethernet is, no, I'm looking for it now because I was like, where did I put it? Oh, yeah. I threw it under there. I'm not going to go get it. But basically, it's a cord, looks kind of like an old phone cord back when we had telephones plugged into the wall. And it speeds up the connection from your router to whatever device you're doing. And in the world of live streaming, we're still mostly talking laptop and desktop. You can do phone, you know, as long as you get the power. That's my problem, is just getting the power. Ethernet is number one. Headphones, number two. Ethernet headphones. Do those and just get comfortable with having those two elements. And please do not tell me that, no, I don't want to use headphones because I really can't hear the student. Because on Zoom, that's a total lie. You can't hear anybody on Zoom anyway because it's Zoom, right? It's Zoom. So go ahead, get your headphones so that way you can hear things better. I do like actually the online lessons because I do feel I can hear some clients a lot better than I ever could. Yeah, it's actually kind of fun for me. So teachers, go ahead and do those two things. Ethernet first. Ethernet's going to help your whole computer life better than Wi-Fi then. But the headphones will help you specifically with the singers. After those two steps, the next thing is a microphone, right? If you can swing it, like even the microphone that's within here, you know, is all right. But if you're willing to start spending money, then you're going to get a nice microphone plus an audio interface. That would be the next steps. And then you can try out different programs. You could try, and then you could get some lighting. You can do all of this piecemeal. You can use a lot of stuff that you had from early pandemic. And that's, you know, you can start doing it gradually and get used to each piece of tech. My rule for tech is I only learn one new tech skill per day or test out one piece of equipment per day. And I don't try to force to do any more. But that way, if I do a little bit at a time, but the time it's live stream day, I've learned stuff for 7 days. That gets a lot easier.
Yeah, that's super important because like tech is not my strong suit. Like I can do stuff, but you generally if I don't have to, I don't want to. and so learning things over time, little bit by little bit, is way more helpful for me. So, because I can get overwhelmed so quickly, you know, and then like, kind of like you said earlier, if something doesn't work and I cannot figure out why, like, I need to go have a good cry about it first, and then I'll try to Google and find a solution. Because I don't feel like I know enough to be able to troubleshoot all the time. But if I start to learn things little by little and get used to one piece of technology, I'm much more likely to find where the disconnect is before I just, you know, take a hammer to it.
For the first 6 months of the pandemic, I didn't do any of this. And I was actually watching the Nats 2020 convention online, right? Back in June. And I had tried some of the apps and things that Dr. Ian Howell had mentioned, but I just couldn't get it to work. And then I was in the YouTube chat or whatever, and I was saying, I said, does somebody want to test this with me? And Wendy Jones said, yes, I'll test it with you. And she's in North Carolina. She's a jazz singer. And so she became my tech wife, and I became her tech wife. And we just started testing stuff because she was not afraid to have it fail and try again. Right. That's the other thing. So Ethernet, headphones, and tech wife. That's what you need. But just having somebody who's willing to test it over and over again. And Dr. Howell did that for me. He did spend a lot of time getting me online at first. So I now help people do that. I actually offer that as a service. But with Wendy, whenever a new piece of tech comes out, I still test it. And I just message her and say, hey, she's not actually teaching right now. She's doing more arranging. But she'll stop and she'll say, okay, I'm free at 7 o'clock tonight. Let's get on and test it. It's really fun.
Yeah, that's super important too, because, and I think this is probably somewhat of just a voice teacher characteristic because of, you know, we did all of our training alone in practice rooms. You know, we did so much of what we had to do alone. And so there's, maybe this is just me, but I think there tends to be a prevailing mindset that we need to figure stuff out alone. We need to do it, but there's help available. I've sent a couple people, your name, you know, that needed help with tech and stuff. So like if I need help with tech, I'm going to outsource that, you know, somebody help me, you know, just teach me. There's that shortens the gap from not knowing to knowing,
especially
just asking for help.
Very true. And since we are already like 2 years in, right, there's a lot more information about how to do this stuff. There's a lot more user guides on all of your favorite channels, right? Restream and eCamera too, that I use a lot, but they they teach people how to do this almost on a daily basis on YouTube. They have tutorials up, and all you have to do is go and click and watch, and you can watch every single day, and you just practice the skill. I will say with live streaming, now you're all good at Zoom, right? Or we're at least good at, we try to be good at Zoom, that the more you do it, the easier it gets, right? You just practice, and then you're not, your workflow gets set up, and it gets easier. It's okay, voice teachers. It's okay if you don't know how to do any of this. I know that it feels really strange to be in a place where you don't know something, because we all know everything. And I felt the same way. But it's also kind of thrilling to learn something new. Mm-hmm. And it's somewhere that not all my clients want to be online. There's several that say, no, I'll just wait until the pandemic's over. It's like, well, mm-hmm. I'll see you when I see you. Yeah. And that's all ages too. I get teenagers who say, I'm sick of online. I get it. Right. Mm-hmm. I get it. But Eliza, the 83-year-old, I taught her online. She got online. Mm-hmm. Right. So it's really, you know, what do you need to accomplish, and can live streaming or use of tech achieve that goal or get you closer to that goal? And if it can, then you're going to use it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you know, this is just the way the world is moving. And so if we don't learn it, you know, chances are, you know, there of course will be people who will not want to do live streaming, who will not want to do video submissions, and will be fine with, you know, doing in person. But with the way our industry is changing, if we don't develop these skills, we run the risk of being left behind or having a very, very small pool of people to pull from as far as clients are concerned. Mm-hmm. And plus, most of my clients are not anywhere near me. You know, I've been able to expand my client base way farther than I would have thought possible even 4 or 5 years ago. So that has been a silver lining of the pandemic, I suppose, if there is one. You know,
That's the thing.
Yes. Like, it's changed my business model in a way that has been very, very positive. It's also, you know, it has stretched me a lot, and I would be fine if the pandemic just, you know, went to whatever, you know, pit of hell that it came from. you know, as long as it's here, I'm going to roll with it, I suppose.
Yeah.
So, going back to the cabaret and the one person shows that you have put together for your clients. You know, we've talked a little bit about the tech skills, and that of course can increase your audience reach too. You know, if you have folks that would love to see, you know, your students work, but you know, like they're in, you know, the other coast or whatever, the technology gives them the opportunity to be able to participate. I think that's wonderful. But for teachers who may be interested in doing that kind of, you know, like, I don't know, I don't want to call it an unrecital, you know, but like that kind of more personalized show, what do you think, what other skills do teachers need to do, or how could they get started maybe trying to take on a different kind of project like that?
First, figure out if your students need it. And if they don't, if everything is going fine, everything is going fine. And I'm thinking more about the specific model of like a teacher who might do 2 recitals a year, you know, Christmas and May or whatever, usually at a church. And that's a really workable model. It's financially viable.
Right.
But it always makes me feel a little icky when I see somebody doing, you know, like, Hey, Big Spender in front of the altar. I don't know. It's just there. But if your singers are singing more contemporary music or music that's really not sacred, then you may want to explore some other options. And you probably have, but maybe they were cost prohibitive. Mm-hmm. And so that's when this unrecital idea begins to show up. Because if you go to a restaurant and say, I want to put on a recital, they're going to say no, right? Because they think a recital is that too. It's like, you know, it's punching cookies in front of the altar. But you say, no, I would like to do a student showcase, and I'd like to have some, you know, snacks. I'd like to, you know, have a price on it so that way they get food. And I'd like to use this space, and I'm going to bring in a piano player and a bassist and a drummer. Can we book? Then they're going to talk to you, right? Mm-hmm. So, but then it's still a recital, because what's the purpose of a recital? It's to show that your students have learned stuff with you, right? It's to celebrate the success of your studio. And you can do that in a lot of ways. So if you are doing the, you know, the church format, then you want to ask yourself, is that really serving my students? And is that getting them closer to what they would be doing in the real world, right? If they're going to sing oratorio, absolutely. And if it's their very first experience and your church or that location is really comfortable, yes, mm-hmm. then keep doing that. But if they're singing pop, if they're singing indie, rock and roll, jazz, then consider putting them closer to the environment where they're going to end up performing.
Mm-hmm.
That's the thing to think about.
How much, considering like your general studio, recital model like that versus a one-person show, what is the time that you would put in like per client for each of those? Because I can imagine there's a big difference in time spent.
It's a lot. It's a lot.
Yeah.
And my last official recital, I don't know, 2015? Mm-hmm. I haven't done one in a very long time. I did a showcase at a student's house where we rolled up the rugs and it was a dance party because she dances with the Fred Astaire Company. She's a big ballroom dancer. So, and she has a daughter with severe disabilities living in her house. So she couldn't come out to a regular recital. Mm-hmm. And I thought, how do I make it possible for this client to be able to do what she wants? So we moved the recital to her house.
Mm-hmm.
And then all of a sudden it was a dance party. She sang with the Talking Heads song. I can't remember it. The Native Mix. Something about a house, not burning down a house, but it was an opener. I can't remember it. I can hear it in my head, but I can't think of it. It's, yeah. Crazy brain. But she opened the show and then we had 10 other people that sang songs and we did twist and shout. We did mm-hmm. all these really, really fun things. And I got in the car when it was over and I said, I'm never going to do a traditional recital again.
Mm-hmm.
This is what my clients benefit from. This is what they're likely to do elsewhere, right? But the prep mm-hmm. for that was, working with the client and going to her house and figuring out where we could do it. It was hiring and rehearsing the band. It was mm-hmm. rehearsing the numbers with every single one of those singers. And then also we videoed it. And so there were all of those different parts that went into it. Mm-hmm. So yes, I don't have very many clients that do exactly that. And I had three last year that did giant projects. So Eliza mm-hmm. was one. And we came up with the idea for her show. We wrote all this original songs together. I got the band to rehearse the band. And then she performed. And now we're going to copyright the songs and actually license them. Those are all the steps I do with her. So mm-hmm. I meet with her once a week, for an hour of rehearsing and planning. And when we are getting closer to showtime, we're meeting 2 hours a week minimum. We're in contact pretty much daily. Mm-hmm. And I copy her on everything I'm sending out to anybody else. So she's aware of what I'm doing, but she trusts me to do that. Then another client wanted to sing with a rock band. He wanted to front a rock band. So mm-hmm. we spent a lot of the pandemic working online, just choosing the songs and figuring out what keys he was comfortable in. Then mm-hmm. it was rehearsing with the band, promotion, and then finding the venue and doing the gig. And so he paid me for a lot of that research time and to put together and to rehearse a band because he didn't know how to talk to a band. Mm-hmm. And then the third one was a singer-songwriter who's housebound. And she really wanted to write songs. So she's very good at writing lyrics and she writes about 2 songs per day. She writes a lot. And she just, art is her therapy, mm-hmm. art is her creativity. And there is a mm-hmm. lot pouring out of her. I'm so impressed. So she'll just send me a picture in the morning and she handwrites. So then she just takes a screenshot of it and puts it in my message inbox in the morning. And then I write back mm-hmm. what lines stuck out to me. And then about mm-hmm. once every 2 to 3 weeks, we choose one that we like. And then I just sit at the piano and I start creating an arrangement of it on piano. So mm-hmm. we meet on Zoom about twice a week and I just sing it back to her. And once she starts laughing, I know we're on the right track. Then I make an arrangement using Logic Pro and my MIDI instruments. And then I keep her involved in that part of the process, although more of it falls to me at this point. But she still has to approve style and she'll say, I think there's too much guitar in here. I think we need a different bass line, things like that. Then sometimes I ship out different parts of it for another professional musician to sing. The one that's coming out this month, actually, our friend Heather Statham mm-hmm. from Secco is the singer on it. It's a blues song called I Thought It Was Love. Mm-hmm. So Heather, I just sent her the demo track. She sent back the vocal. I got another guitarist friend to record a scorching guitar part. And now Robin is making the artwork for the video. So this weekend, I will put all of that together and then we'll choose a release date and then we'll release on YouTube. Actually, I don't release to Spotify or anywhere else at this time. And then we'll have a premiere party and Robin will talk about the process and then we'll release the song. So that's a lot of work. Yes, mm-hmm. I have those skills so I can do this pretty quickly. And things I cannot do, I have relationships with other people to kind of farm out to make mm-hmm. it easier. And so we actually get it done in a timely manner.
Right. So yeah, so again, you don't have to do everything.
No. And actually, the more I do this, the more I am farming out more of the stuff to other people who I realize can do it better. I have a relationship with a recording studio, several recording studios, actually. So I can send different pieces to them. And for clients who want that, they're willing to do it. Right. Mm-hmm. And there, I have plenty of clients who this is not for them. And they said, oh, thanks, mm-hmm. Eden, but I really just need coaching for this little part. That's fine, too. Mm-hmm. Whatever we can do to advance you to what you want to do, that's great. But I think a lot of people just don't know what they want to do. Mm-hmm. Or they know, but they don't think they can.
Ooh, yeah.
Yeah. And mm-hmm. I say, yes, you can. But what you immediately when you think that, right? I want to climb Mount Everest. I would love to climb Mount Everest. Okay, what do you have to do to climb Mount Everest? You got a lot of steps, right? Mm-hmm. Are you willing to do the steps? And if the answer is no, okay, you accept that. But if the answer is, oh, I could do like 4 of those steps. Who can help me with the other 45? That's what I do, mm-hmm. right? I know most of my clients can do several of those steps. I'm here to be an accountability partner mm-hmm. and to help support you when you get to the step that's tough mm-hmm. to help you get on going. So that way it doesn't stay a dream. It actually becomes mm-hmm. reality.
Yeah. I can see, especially for like your particular studio model, like you have, when you're working with a client, like doing a show like that, like it seems like you really know your clients well. And so that you're able to not only get them what they need, get them what they want, but also get them through it. Cause you know, part of our job sometimes is, you know, encourager, coach, cattle prodder, you know, and we have to know what kind of encouragement works for people, you know, yeah. cause if you are, you know, if you go at it with, you know, one particular client, more like a drill sergeant, they're going to shut down, but other clients, you know, will really respond to that. So being able to know how your clients, you know, work with, encouragement and being able to do that, that takes a pretty good relationship between client and teacher.
Absolutely. I mean, I say hard things and I don't do the big projects unless I know the client pretty well. So it doesn't happen mm-hmm. instantly. There's often, you know, I start with a hello lesson, which is like an initial fit lesson where we do mm-hmm. a lot of talking and singing and everybody walks in nervous to that, whether mm-hmm. they're in person or online, and they all are stunned at how nervous they are. Like, I'm not stunned. This is nerve wracking and I'm a judgmental mm-hmm. biatch. So come on. Right now. What I usually do is I actually clean my desk while they're singing. And that way I'm not like watching, you mm-hmm. know, and judging and everything. And they'll kind of, where'd you go? Like, well, I was just over here cleaning. Of course I'm listening, but mm-hmm. I know that that's stressful. And actually I do a lot of my best singing when I'm just like walking around the room. And so I want my client to feel comfortable and go ahead, do your best singing as you can. Just be really casual. You know, this is not a big deal. This is not a performance. Right. Mm-hmm. This is us getting to know each other. And then yeah. over time, you know, I'd have several different layers of kind of opportunity in my studio and I'm always working on that. So some mm-hmm. of my clients are guests on the Eden Show because it's a place to perform online. Some mm-hmm. come to the open mics. I host an open mic every month at a local music venue. It's a chance to get up on stage and sing with a live band because I know what kind of a drug that is. And when you do it, then it makes you want to do more. And if you get up there and you sing whatever you're singing, right? Or Olivia Rodrigo or Misty or whatever, once you've done it and you realize how it feels and that mm-hmm. you did it, it makes you want to do more. And that's why we voice teachers exist, is because our clients want us to help them do more. So I mm-hmm. think most voice teachers do a fantastic job of choosing repertoire and helping with technical work. I think a lot of voice teachers fall flat when it comes to taking that improved voice and figuring out where to put it next. Mm-hmm. Because we just yeah. don't know. Once you leave the college environment, what do you do? And what happens if you prepare students for musical theater and then they can't get cast in their local community production of something mm-hmm. because they don't meet the criteria or they can't make the rehearsals because they have a disability or they have a job at night? Where are they going to perform? What if they can't mm-hmm. walk into a bar? Where do they perform? They're looking to you not only
for, you know, the guidance and the technical skill, but also a little bit of direction about where to go. And that's where I think I feel a real need. But voice teachers who are watching, you can fill that need in a way that doesn't kill you either. You know, I'm talking about doing things that knock myself out, right? And that take a lot of time. But my casual thing is, you know, a coffee house once a month. Mine happens to be in a music venue. But if you do a coffee house, if you host a Zoom meeting where people can sing, you're doing that. You're showing them ways to perform and you're holding them accountable. And that's really, really important. I'm so glad that you're doing that. And if you haven't done that yet, go ahead and do it.
Yeah, it could also, I see, I agree with you. I think there's a big need. We're not taught that in our music programs. You're like how to like do the actual career part. Usually, you know, especially if you come from a classically based program, you know, like they're trying to teach you how to get into, you know, recital venues and opera houses and not, not dive bars. You know, like some of my teachers would probably flip out, you know, if they knew half the places that I sang before, you know, but, you know, that's, if we don't know how to do that, first of all, we can find someone who can help us, you know, again, just, you know, ask questions, you know, pay for somebody's time to sit down with you and, you know, like, okay, how could I do this for my client? You don't have to figure it out on your own. You know, there's ways to do it. But I also see benefit too, if we were brave enough to like do this for ourselves, you know, like get the teacher on stage at the dive bar, you know, you as a teacher put together a one person show, you know, and see what it takes, you know, for you to do it from start to finish so that you can like kind of experiment on yourself before you, you know, bring an innocent client into it.
So true. I am working on a one woman show this year myself. And it's actually about Madeline Kahn. So it's called Kahn Artist.
I remember the thread about naming this. I'm so excited about it.
Yeah. And my director and coach is Faith Prince, who is a Tony Award winner. And she went to University of Cincinnati. Go Bearcats. Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. Who day? Okay, right. Yeah. But so she was at CCM before I was there. And so we feel this connection, right? This wonderful Bearcat connection. Mm-hmm. So I took a class last summer. I was at the St. Louis Cabaret Conference and she was one of the coaches. We had four fantastic coaches. So she's helping me build it. And she's asking me all the questions that I ask of my clients. But it's so different, teachers, when somebody asks you those same questions you ask of your students. I mean, she just hit me at the solar plexus with a couple of them. And it was great. You know, I get students in my lessons who cry, right? And I say, oh, it's okay. I cried when Faith Prince asked me about my childhood. Huh? But it was great. And I realized, oh yeah. I get that exhilaration feeling that my students are getting. And yes, when your teachers are performing, it makes us better teachers. So I'm really doing this. And this is my, I think my fourth cabaret. So my fourth full length one. And so I know I'm going to come out of this with a lot of better stuff to talk to with my own clients. But it's really exciting and terrifying in all the best ways.
Yeah, it's like I think there's some benefit in feeling abject terror on occasion, you know, and remembering what that's like, you know, because we can, if we don't do it, we can forget, you know, and what it's like to be in that performer spot when we are, you know, in the teacher spot so often, you know, we feel, at least I do, I feel terror from teaching sometimes just because, you know, it's a heavy responsibility sometimes to hold somebody's voice in your hands, you know, especially, you know, when I've done, you know, work in the past with, you know, folks that have had vocal injury, you know, that's a really tender time. And, you know, I want to respect that and Tara makes you pay attention. That is true. Yeah. That is absolutely true. But I just, you know, I want to honor their, my clients, wherever they are. And, I want to still be able to relate to them, you know, in as many ways as I possibly can. So yeah, feeling terror every once in a while, not a bad thing.
It really is good. I mean, they do the thing that scares you, right? But it doesn't mean you have to do it all at once. It's a little bit at a time, right? How do we develop, you know, the antidote to poison, right? You eat a little bit every day. So, you know, just do little bits here and there. I didn't live stream an entire show right away. Actually, it was a little bit at a time over a period of months. And this cabaret is going to come out in dribs and drabs. And I know that I have a couple of places where I can go to test out sections of it over the next several months. Thank goodness, because I would never try to do this without that. And I won't let my clients do that either. They have to try this stuff out in some way, shape, or form before they do the big project. And that way, when they actually get to the big date, it's okay. And it turns out great, usually.
So. And two, like, especially trying out, you know, if something goes wrong, you get the opportunity to practice how to recover, because chances are high, you know, that something's going to go wrong in the big performance, and you don't want that to be the first time that you have to think on your feet, being able to, you know, shuffle step a little bit or whatever to get to, you know, get the train back on the rails. If I don't know, I'm mixing metaphors all over the place. But, you
know, well, whatever. And with tech will go wrong. It will. It will. So I saw actually a live streamed cabaret for the Green Room 42 in New York on Saturday night in the middle of our blizzard, right? And it was a TikTok star, Kaisha Hoogley. Hoogley was her name. She's fabulous. She's fabulous. TikTok star, Instagram star, got so many followers. And she had challenged herself to do a one-woman show this year. And she did it. She nailed it. And she used technology in the middle of it. So she had this cool little app where you could choose which Skylar Sister song you wanted her to do. And she would do whatever the people voted on. I love that kind of interactivity. Just turns me on. But right when she was telling everybody, here's how you snap the QR code, viewers. So she had 48 people watching online. She probably had about 60 or 70 in the room. And right when she said, all you have to do is, the feed stopped.
Oh, no.
I thought, oh, right. Of course it did. Because things go wrong in live streams. So I voted. I didn't get to see it, but I got to vote. Yeah. And then it got back online about 25 minutes later. But all of us that were watching her online, we just chatted with each other and prayed it would come back. And it wasn't her fault. You know, it was the venue or the feed, right? It was the middle of a blizzard. Something went wrong. That's what happens. And she didn't know, right? Because she's busy performing for the people who were in front of her. So if that happens, realize that, yeah, I know you feel like you just went out with, you know, a rip in your pants. It's okay. We all forgave her. I got to see the last number. She did a great job. And overall, my impression is positive of her. So I'm not going to remember, you know, that what that happened. I'm going to remember how awesome she was. And that's the same for you guys with live streams. They're really going to remember that you took the time, you tried it, and that you're awesome. That's all they really care about. I do think that in the next 5 years, less than that, less than that, live streaming will become the norm. It is a completely different kind of performing than anything else you do. So it's different than your standard recital. Hi, Fraser. Hi, Liz. It's different than going to the bar. It's different than being on a community stage or a main theatrical stage. And it's different than just doing like a pre-recorded anything. It really is its own animal because it's interactive. That's the main benefit. And so you really do get to talk with your audience. Thank you. I worked on it. I used some new Redken today. Yeah, very happy. So think of it that way. Don't try to make it anything else. All right. That's where I think a lot of live streamers get into trouble is they think, well, I'll just perform. And they never acknowledge the audience. Mistake. Yeah, pre-recorded is late. Or if you're going to pre-record, do it, but then have a watch party. So that way there's still that interactivity, right? So that's important. It's really important. I do think that when theaters and venues realize they can save money by doing kind of live streamed rehearsals and performing, they will do more of it. The big ones, right? Like I just saw an ad that Bernadette Peters, right? She's performing out in the West sometime in the next few months. And in addition to being in the Giant Performing Theater, they are live streaming that event through stellartickets.com, which is a wonderful, wonderful website. And so they're going to have, you know, 10 different cameras on her. The sound is going to be incredible. It's going to be like watching TV, but it will be a live stream. What they will probably not do is interact with everybody. And so therefore it's a little bit less than. So what would be really great is that if they had like a moderator or a host, kind of like it Live from the Met, right? Where they've got somebody talking about it in between all those scene changes. So that way it really feels unique and it's a special experience unto itself. So I do think that that is where we're going to be heading. And so live streaming will become its own kind of special thing with more behind the scenes type things and interviews with performers. So you'll feel like you're there. And in fact, it'll be even more fun than being there. And then you can charge a higher price for it. And then all of a sudden, you're in a different business. I think that's where we are headed within a few years.
Yeah. Interactivity. I mean, it makes the audience feel special mm-hmm. that they get an interaction from an artist, you know, that, hey, they're paying attention to me or whatever. And let's be honest, for me as a performer or even just an Instagram liver person, it feeds my ego a little bit when I see people are interacting with me.
Yes.
Win-win.
Win-win. Yes. It's true. It's really true. And so you can have this, luckily, in an accessible way. You don't need to have your own producer to make this happen. You don't need an agent. You can mm-hmm. interact with the people who care about you and people you care about. So it's available now. It feels really overwhelming. So just start with one, right? Mm-hmm. One little task or one little thing to practice. And if you don't know which one to start with, call me. I'll tell you what to start with.
Yeah. I mean, it can be as simple as, you know, just streaming a song and, you know, talking about, you know, this is why I chose the song today. You know, whatever. Mm-hmm. Really. Yeah. You can start small. When I first started doing live videos, I've done several of them, you know, over the last year and a half or so, but the first few times you hit that, you know, go live button can be like, ugh.
Yeah.
You know, it can really be a thing, but you know, the more you do it, it's like, you know, I haven't died yet. So, you know, it's like, I'm still standing and mm-hmm. what's the worst that can happen? You know, honestly, I'm probably not going to say something super, you know, super offensive. And if I do, you know, it will be an accident. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like technology could, you know, like thwart my efforts. You just try it again, do it again. You know, and then you get better and better. And hopefully I am getting better and better as I go along. You know, it's just, it's a thing. It's the reality now. And it really can be fun.
It really can. Yeah. Dead air. That's the worst possible thing, right? Yeah. But you know what? Even dead air looks exciting on a live stream. Mm-hmm. It's really strange. It does, because people like to look, people are voyeurs and they like to see what else is going on in everybody else's life. I love watching this vlog on YouTube by a beautiful Japanese woman who never shows her face, right? It's all ASMR and she's just chopping up vegetables all day long in her little tiny apartment in Tokyo, and the music mm-hmm. is all tinkly. She makes many exotic forms of tea. I find her fascinating and she is my visual break for the day. Right? So I'm mm-hmm. always thinking, could I do that? Could I pull that off? Or am I too much of a Leo to do that? The answer is number two. But she's just going about her day. Now it's a heavily curated day, right? Mm-hmm. And she films in advance, but that's exciting content to somebody else for me halfway around the world. So viewers who are watching, you are interesting. And the things that you do are interesting to other people, not in a stark mm-hmm. way. So it's okay to take a little tiny bit of that and share mm-hmm. that online, especially if it would benefit somebody else. Like, you know, here's a vocalist that really helps me. 1 minute, mm-hmm. done, right?
Yep.
Here's a song I'm teaching this week. And one thing I think everybody should know about this song is make sure you breathe in this spot, right? Mm-hmm. The other thing you can do is you can put out a call if you need something. Hey, everybody, I'm looking for a place to do a showcase. Does anybody know of a coffee house that's available? Instead of typing it, video it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So that way you begin to build that little bit of interactivity. And then suddenly you're starting to build on your skills. And if you can't do that, you get one of your technologically connected students to help you with that process. They'll be mm-hmm. glad to help you. Have yeah. them be on it with you. If you don't feel comfortable doing it, you say, hey, let's film this together. And you ask them to do it for you. And then you're in the shot. Hey, can you copy that to my account? Yes, they can.
Yeah. That's how Phyllis Horridge got started on TikTok. Like one of her students really? In a lesson basically grabbed her phone and did it for her. And now she's yeah. like total TikTok domination as far as the voice teacher world is concerned.
Yeah, she totally is. I mean, bless yeah. her. I have like 5 TikToks up. Insta is like my third platform. YouTube is my number one. Mm-hmm. And then YouTube and then Facebook and Twitch are my big 3. I love Twitch. Mm-hmm. And I should give it more time than I do. So, but in addition to my, you know, one woman show with Eden show every Thursday, it's mostly Thursdays. Sometimes it moves around a little bit. I'm probably going to start a second show where it's much more just interactive, just me playing stuff, because I need the accountability of playing for people.
Mm-hmm.
And because I'm as a performer, I've had a lot of dates canceled lately. I don't know about anybody else. I mean, there's kind of this variant going out. Mm-hmm. And so it's kind of wrecked my performing schedule in a big way. Mm-hmm. So I just lost my third gig, and between the variant and venue owners, I've lost like 3 jobs in the past 48 hours. And mm-hmm. it's really tough, but my live stream is happening Thursday night, 7:00 Eastern, 6:00 Central. And my guest is in Germany. And we are playing live together while he's in Germany and I'm over here. And we're actually, yeah, thinking bringing in a singer from Portugal and a guitarist from London. And the four of us are going to be playing live together in real time on my live stream. I hope.
That's incredible.
Probably going to work. We've been testing it all week to make sure it works. But I find that kind of thrilling. And mm-hmm. it's a thrill, especially that even if my local venues are closed, I can always get online. And that can be how I perform. That's what I mean about offering alternatives for your students, but also for yourself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
I just don't want another week to go by where I lose more, you know, venues for things that are outside my control. So I have said that so many times in the past 6 months as I'm schlepping my keyboard from place to place. This is why I live stream, right? This is why mm-hmm. I live stream. It doesn't replace live performing. It's adjacent right. to. It's adjacent to.
Yeah. It's just a different thing and, yeah. and add to. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you've kind of already talked about this, but I'm going to ask it explicitly, but how has all of the stuff that you've been doing in the past, you know, 18 months, 2 years, whatever, I don't know. I've lost time is a completely vague construct at this point, but how has all of this made you a better performer?
Oh, just having the chance to play more. Mm-hmm. The Eden Show is my accountability too, because I'm playing 5 or 6 songs a week and they're always different with different people mm-hmm. and different styles. So my guest this week is Bernd Kuhl, who is based in Cologne, Germany. And so he has a different relationship to music than I do. And I never would have met him otherwise. I've never met him in person. Mm-hmm. But he came up with this really eclectic set list of a lot of things I've never heard of. And it's just so exciting. Right? To mm-hmm. feel like I'm growing as a musician and I have to practice my piano playing, you know, to be good for them, to be supportive for them. So I think it's helped for that reason. Just hearing myself better in headphones and microphones has made me a more subtle singer. Mm-hmm. And so I'm recording much more than I ever have before. And I think my recording voice has gotten better. I can still project when I need to, but I love mm-hmm. the intimacy of recording. So I think that those two skills have really gotten sharper and more attenuated because of this process.
Mm-hmm. We do. Yeah, that's a real thing. You know, having done a lot of worship music and working with worship singers, you know, the inner monitors that a lot of worship teams use anymore, that's a whole different thing than doing, you know, like either no monitors or floor monitors, you know, and it takes a little bit of getting used to because our brains just process that sound a little bit differently because of, you know, like where it is, it's not getting like the actual acoustic feedback, you know, because it's you got something like plugging your ears. Mm-hmm. And so it could take a little bit to get used to that. And, you know, practicing that is an important skill, I think, too.
It was so weird to go and record music for Easter last year because we were still mm-hmm. kind of pandemic, right? But to hear my voice actually bounce on the church and come back again, it's like, I haven't heard that in a while. Mm-hmm. And the Episcopal Church, where my husband is a member, they actually got a grant to buy a lot of audio and video equipment. My husband does some audio and video production. I don't get to benefit from it that much. Everything I do, I have to do with my own stuff. So don't feel like, you know, he's doing it all for me. He's doing, no, he's not. But he's willing mm-hmm. to talk to me about it. So the church bought all of the same equipment. So that way that's there. So that way their choir will sound good when they live stream. And they do. They still live stream about once a month for whoever's not mm-hmm. in town. We get a lot of snowbirds in our community. So they can watch in Florida until they come back up. We also mm-hmm. have such good acoustics in that church that he can record concerts. And so they're actually expanding their concert series because they mm-hmm. now have the recording equipment and they've got the ability to live stream. Their annual meeting is next Sunday. I'm the moderator on Zoom for it because I'm the one who knows how to do that. But it's my job to set up the workflow. And they actually looked at me and said, well, you know how to do it because you do all that live streaming stuff, right? So I got nominated. but I'm thrilled to see the church being willing to do that and make the mm-hmm. investment in that. And I think long-term it will benefit them. It will benefit all the parishioners, whether they've been there for 60 years or, yep. you know, six minutes. It's really mm-hmm. an important step forward for them. And I'm really glad they're doing it.
Yeah, I agree with that too. So how has all of this that you've been doing made you a better teacher?
It's forced me to have to think ahead more. And I can't fly by the seat of my pants as much as I did in lessons. Mm-hmm. I actually now have I schedule through Acuity. And I actually ask at the beginning when they're scheduling, what are we working on? So mm-hmm. that way I can get my mind a little more in gear before they show up. Mm-hmm. I definitely have to be able to punt more within the lessons as far as, okay, this tech doesn't work, let's try something else. Mm-hmm. Most of the time, though, I get students, we start on Zoom, and we just hope Zoom is going to work enough for what we want to do. Right. Especially if I'm working on a karaoke track, it's like, okay, that's fine. You're doing all of the sound making on your end. It just comes into me. We don't need to set anything fancy up. But then if more tech gets involved, it's true. Some lessons become a little more about tech, and mm-hmm. we just do what we can within those limitations. So I think I'm a more patient teacher because I also understand that that's very frustrating for some singers. Mm-hmm. And you must work within whatever they bring you. So if I get a student who has, you know, a 10-year-old iPhone, and that's what they have that day, then that's what we work with. And we mm-hmm. we do the best we can. And I also get, you know, students who say, I don't want to come in until COVID is over. I'm like, mm-hmm. okay. So it's forced me to have a boundary in that area too. Yeah. But I needed to have that boundary as a teacher. And it's okay, teachers, for you to set whatever boundaries you want for your mm-hmm. studio. It's your studio, your family, your life. And so even though I try to individualize what I do for clients, I still have boundaries on what I'm willing to do. And I don't mm-hmm. bend them. I don't bend them.
Yeah. Yeah, I have been online totally since March of 2020 or so, and I'm probably not going to go back to in-person, you know, because I, you know, probably, well, maybe with some select people that can come into my house that I can trust, mm-hmm. but I am also enjoying not having strangers parading through my house, you know, like yeah. every night. It's really nice.
I got new carpet in here, and it stays a lot cleaner. I don't have people coming in here. And this room is a multi-purpose room. This is a studio right near the front of my house. And I'm moving things around all the time. And so while I would love to have a studio that is so beautiful and is set up to welcome people who can sit and relax, that's not really what it is right now. And mm-hmm. so, you know, I think it can be one or the other. So when I do have people over, it tends to be a small group, and we tend to go out in my living room, which is a little bit bigger and more ventilated. But yeah, I think that's just the way it is. I think that this is all getting a little more normalized as time goes mm-hmm. on, and it's going to get easier and easier. Having better audio makes online anything so much better. So there's a whole bunch of connectors on my site, edencastile.com. I talk about low latency and the different programs I use. And mm-hmm. I have an entire YouTube playlist of these different low latency experiments I've done with different musicians. So you can see how we use the tech. And we're using it for jam sessions, but really it can be used for performance. It can be used for rehearsals. It can be used in a variety of different ways.
I need to go bookmark that playlist for sure.
Yeah.
All right. And then how do you think all of this has made you a better business owner?
Well, that's a good question. I was just telling you actually in Speakeasy that, you know, I just got my tax form for 2021. I made the same in 2020 and almost the same in 2021. Mm-hmm. I thought for sure it was less because everybody suffered, right? I mean, I definitely took a hit in 2020 when I didn't have, because I was still teaching in person at that point, right?
Right.
So, but I was really stunned that even in 2021, I basically held steady, even though I had a lot fewer people, but they were doing these giant projects, right? These really intense mm-hmm. projects. And so I charged more for those clients who were doing this intense work. And I still had a lot of people who were preparing for college auditions or a church mm-hmm. solo or things like that. And I still take on those clients. But I was glad that it wasn't as much of a financial hit as I thought it was going to be. At which point, Michelle, our leader, said, then you need to crunch your numbers better, Eden. She's right. I do. So it's made me clearer about what I offer and what I want to offer. Mm-hmm. And, you know, who I really want to reach out to. And who I should refer out to somebody else. So it's been good mm-hmm. for that.
Yeah, I agree. Especially being able to network with people and being able to refer people is super helpful. So I can really take on the people that I really serve well and just, you know, serve them as best as I can without having, you know, like either the energy vampires or, you know, people that, you know, I just, you know, are just taking on because I have no reason to not to, whatever. Mm-hmm. Okay. So you already mentioned your website, edencastile.com, but like where are the other places that people can find you?
That's the main one. There are links there for everything. I'm on here and there is an Instagram page for the Eden Show called Eden Show Live. if you want to check that out, where I talk about what's going to be happening. And then I'd usually put up some clips from previous shows on there. But if you want to see every show, they're all in a playlist on YouTube. So that's YouTube.com/C/EdenCastile. I'm the only Eden Castile on there. So, but that's all 42 episodes. If you want to go back, and it's jazz, blues, comedy, singer, songwriters, folk, rock and roll, a little bit of everything, and more of that to come in the new year. So those are the big places I'm on. And then on Facebook, you can find me all over there as well.
Yeah, very good. Is there anything else that I didn't ask that you want to let people know about or tell people about?
I'm just looking to say, I'm looking at the questions you had before. You did so good.
Thanks.
I covered a whole bunch of things. So you said, like, who is my ideal client?
I forgot to ask that.
That's okay. If you are a refugee from some other performing arts, basically, where you may have trained in one area and you've had some success in that area, but the success seems to have slowed down or stopped or reversed, and you don't know why, or you do know why, but you don't know what to do about it, right? Also, people who are just bored. They have been doing the same thing for a while and you're looking for a new challenge, but you're not quite as sure what challenge you're up for. And you don't know anything about it. Those are my big two. But that, I think, actually means I could teach anybody, because we've all been through that period of life. And everybody in these past 2 years, right, is reevaluating every life choice they ever made. And people who are choir singers, and they're getting back into choir, but it doesn't feel the way it did. Or community theater. I get a lot from community theater, because they used to get cast all the time, and then suddenly they're a little bit too old. Or the community theater shut, or for some reason they're not, or they're just doing shows that don't interest them anymore. What can I do? Right? There's plenty you can do. And I consider it a personal mission to help you figure out what you're going to do next to help get you there. Because the answer should never be, maybe I should just stop. Maybe this is a sign I should just stop. No, no, no. It's a sign to do something else. And by doing that other thing, and by taking your dreams of music and just shifting ever so slightly one way or the other, you will open up this entirely new world of music, and you get to keep everything you've already done and carry it forward into a place that serves you better, lets you connect with new people.
Yeah, that's fantastic. All right. Well, Eden, thank you so much for joining me today. I had so much fun talking to you, and I hope that we can maybe do this again sometime.
Anytime. So I hope to see you all on the Eden Show Thursdays. And thank you so much, Heather. It was delightful to talk to you.
Absolutely. All right. Well, thanks for watching, everybody, and we will see you later.
Bye.
Bye.